Michael was the one that was appointed by God to challenge Jezebel. And when he challenged Jezebel, Baal could not unleash that onslaught of calling forth the worship of idols. That should explain to you what I'm teaching you tonight. Let's go back to where did Jezebel and Ahab succeed? Because Jezebel submitted to Baal, and Jezebel was the wife of Ahab. But Jezebel was in rebellion, and she usurped the authority of Ahab. So she managed to rule Israel indirectly. That spirit on her called Baal operated through her to bewitch the people of God. So they were confused, or they were double-minded. So when they became double-minded, the prophets of God were persecuted, killed, or put in a situation where they can't function. Because prophets of God are supposed to preach the truth. So the people began to rebel. And that's why God raised up Elijah to challenge Jezebel. Now let me show you something that's so powerful. When Elijah wanted to offer sacrifice to God, he had to destroy the altar of Baal. He had to destroy what?
The altar of Baal.
Yes. You said, how? What do you mean he destroyed the altar? He destroyed the prophets of Baal afterwards. But before he could do that, he challenged the prophets of Baal to set up an altar and offer sacrifice and call forth rain to their God. And they did everything and no rain came. So when he repaired the altar of God, which had been destroyed by the prophets of Baal, by their teachings, by their deception, the people of God who were watching the show now realize that if the Baal, the prophets of Baal and their God cannot bring fire, let's see what Elijah's God can do. Elijah did not say, "Lord, answer me," before repairing the altar. He repairs the altar first, then he asks the Lord to answer him. What do you mean by, why did he have to repair the altar? Why? Let me explain to you why. Because repentance and renunciation of iniquity and sin, or the acts of wickedness, is what opens up the door for restoration. Amen. You cannot be restored unless you are reconciled with God.
Amen.
You will not be restored. I mean, you could travel all around America and people prophesy to you, lay hands and you fall all on your head until your hair is greasy. It will not work. I'm being honest with you. Until the altar is what? Repair. Your heart is the altar. The first level of brokenness is reconciliation with God. If you're not seeking God to reconcile with them, you will not be restored. Elijah knew what God spoke. And when he challenged the prophets of Baal, he stood on his ground. He knew their God would not show up, and their God never what? Showed up. But when he repaired the altar, reconciliation, brokenness, repentance, then he said, "Lord, answer me." And the Lord answered, and fire came from heaven, consumed the sacrifice. Great sign. Now, let's go to Saul. King Saul is instructed by God to kill everybody. Samuel came to Saul, verse 13, and so said unto him, "Blessed be thou the Lord, I have performed the commandment of the Lord." And Samuel said, "What meaneth then this? Bleating of the sheep in my ears, and lowing of the oxen which I hear?" And so said they, "They brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God." and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Verse 3. Verse 7, chapter 15, verse 3. Thus said the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Now God smite Amalek, utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both men and women, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass, and so gather the people together and number them in Telaim, 200,000 footmen, and then and 10,000 men of Judah, and so came to the city of Amalek and laid wait in the valley. What was the instruction? Destroy all. Verse 3 says what? Now go and smite Amalek and utterly. By the way, even those boys in the Bible slept. You know the one that fell off the roof and the apostle raised him from the dead. So if you fell dead, brother, I'll call you back to life. On condition that you have to utterly destroy all that they have and spare them not, but slay both men and women, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. Now what the Apostle will say here? Now go and smite Amalek and utterly destroy all they have. Do not spare them, but kill. What's God doing here? He's paying back these people. They destroyed. Greed came in. Now, verse 9, Amplified Bible. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the beast of the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fatness of the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them, but everything that was vile and refuse, that they destroyed utterly. What did they do wrong, Saul and his team? They misinterpreted the instruction of God. They picked what they could destroy and picked what they could keep. That explains to you what is in our generation today. In most churches in America, they don't teach obedience, they teach choice, pick and choose, consecrate what God has not consecrated, homosexuality. And you have a homosexual preacher going to Whole Foods and getting a cake and then going back home and drawing a picture or writing something that is against homosexuality and then called a media. So he can get attention and then files a lawsuit that they're discriminating against him. He's a preacher. Imagine a church of homosexuals. Jesus will never show up there. But he apologized because he literally came to find out that he just made up the story. So he had to apologize about it. He's married to a man. So what do you expect? He's married, what? So he apologized to his partner, because I'm not going to call him his wife, because that's not a wife. Amen?
Amen.
So he apologized to his partner and apologized to all foods who had done a counter lawsuit against him. So they dropped the lawsuit. That's a form of rebellion whereby the homosexuals hold a Bible. You have lesbians as preachers, bishops as homosexuals. And then also you have the adulterers. They have more than one wife. That is a rebellion. When God put men to sleep, he took up one rib, not six ribs, and the people say,
amen.
So if you plan to marry more than one, you're violating the scripture. And the people say it.
Amen.
Yeah, it's because I met this preacher said, no, he allows his members to marry as many as he wants, but that's not what the Bible teaches. So we have to go back to the drawing line. So the enemy wants to come in and bend the word, give you every excuse. But God is willing to work with you as long as you genuinely ask him to strengthen you. But those people that purposely rebel against the word of God, they become bewitched and begin to practice this witchcraft rebellion. And it's just a matter of time whereby, you know, he's going to run out. The grace of God is sufficient for us, but it doesn't mean because the grace is sufficient, we should rebel. No, we're supposed to reconcile with God all the time. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Never, ever go to bed without repenting.
Amen.
You say, why? I didn't do nothing wrong. I didn't go to the club. I didn't party. I didn't smoke. No, you don't have to party or go to the club or to smoke, to sin. There are many things we do. We sin with our imaginations. We sin with our thoughts. You know, so we have to repent. Everybody say, repentancy.
Repentance
is a prerequisite.
It's a prerequisite
to spiritual growth.
Spiritual
you have to
growth.
Repent all the time. Not through condemnation, but through the love of God. Your love for God, because you want to maintain a relationship with God. So you're always going to repent. So that way, you can keep a healthy relationship with God, because God is calling you to reconciliation. Your passion and zeal for God. I find myself in a situation where I have to really approach God from the seat of humility. One time the Lord summoned me into his presence, and I found myself in this sanctuary. It was big, but there was nobody. It was only me. And when I looked up, the Lord was sitting on the throne. It was just me and him, and I began to worship him, and I was singing the song, take me into the Holy of Holies, take me in by the blood of the Lamb, take me into the Holy of Holies, take the call, cleanse my lips, here I am. Amen. You know what that means? Forget about everybody who's around you. It's just you and the Lord. You've been invited into the Holy of Holies. So it's just you and the Lord. So if it is me and the Lord in fellowship, how is the enemy going to access that point? No way. How does the enemy push believers to rebel? It doesn't happen drastically. It builds. Because what? Build slowly by slowly. Do you notice all these crazy people from Hollywood? I'm sorry to use the word crazy, but they are crazy. The behavior shows who really they are. They used to go to church when they were in Sunday school. They used to go to what? Beyonce used to be in a youth group. Destiny Child used to sing gospel songs. Michael Jackson used to be in church. When they became teenagers, they thought, well, I don't have to go to church or do what the church says. This is America. I do what I want to do. Will you do what you want to do and go to hell? Or you do what the word of God says and go to heaven? And to be honest with you, from the age of 21, to 35, that age is the most challenging age. From 21 to 35, the most unchurched age in America. It's either they're young or they're above 35. So between 21 to 35, that age faces a lot of temptation. And most of them backslide. We've seen it in our ministry here. When they were in the youth group, they were active. Right, once they hit that